Hello, darlings. You've all heard of Marilyn Monroe. Some of you know Bridget Bardot. Well, now it's time for the Cognac Show. I said Cognac, ooh, ooh. I said Cognac, ooh, ooh, ooh. I'm a bubbly blonde, fabulously dressed.
Funny how everything can change in an instant. A stranger can come along and in the blink of an eye just destroy everything.
Like I showed you.
Sutter plant. It's been closed for years.
I saw someone there yesterday while I was jogging. A boy.
A boy?
She never came home last night.
I'm gonna go find her.
Sutter!
If they have no feelings, they can't know fear. But if they can't know fear, why do they run?
Welcome back. I'm Cognac Willaline, and we are here at the Macabre Film Festival right here in Rockville Center, New York. And I'm here with this fabulous director, Stephen Mena, and he is the director of Bereavement, this fabulous film that is being shown here at the festival. Now, explain to my audience about this film, Bereavement. What is the synopsis of the film?
Well, Bereavement is all about it's a serial killer movie about a man who kidnaps a young boy who suffers from this very rare disease called SIPA. It's congenital insensitivity to pain. And he doesn't realize that the boy has this affliction. And what the whole idea behind it is, he kidnaps this boy to kind of follow in his footsteps of being a murderer. And eventually the boy grows up and eventually consumes, you know, giving a little bit away, but he consumes his captor. And it's kind of a Freudian study of nature versus nurture, about whether or not we are born bad, born serial killers, or are we, you know, influenced by
words,
our environment.
Are we born predestined to be evil?
Are we born bad, or are we made bad by our environment?
What do you think?
I think it's a little bit of both. I think there's got to be something inherent in the brain to make them insensitive
Just plain evil.
Yeah, some people, I think, just have that little defect that they are just genuinely evil from birth.
Where did you go to find your research?
A lot of the research I did was just on the internet. There was some things that happened actually very close to home. In fact, this is an interesting story. There was a serial killer where I grew up in East Meadow. Who murdered, I think, 18 or 19 girls in his apartment, living downstairs from his mom. His mom never knew anything about it. Nobody in the town knew anything about it, and these were all local girls. And a lot of people ask me when they see Bereavement, oh, it's very unrealistic because how could he have gotten away with this for so long? And I say, well, listen, this guy in my movie lived in a derelict building that was closed down for 30 years in the middle of nowhere, where his nearest neighbor was a mile away. And he got away with it. And I grew up in an area which was very densely populated, over a million people in Nassau County, and this guy got away with this, murdering 19 girls in a very short span in a very densely populated area. So to me, it's very realistic that people would overlook things like this that are going on, because it's really happening under their nose and they have no idea what to make of it or how to even begin to find these people. If you compare even if just the recent shootings that just happened in Connecticut, if you look at the pictures of these kids and look at their eyes, you can see that there's a genuine disconnect that's taking place. I just don't think that they look at the world and look at other human beings in the same way that we do. I think that's also why you have to have some kind of a morality play in your films, because you need that balance.
Yeah, the film has to have some kind of integrity.
It's got to have integrity and it's got to have a moral center, because I think if you go too far off in one direction, then it's no longer entertainment.
Very fascinating. Before, I was listening to you talk about making independent films today and that it doesn't have to be so expensive. Is that really true?
A lot of things have changed for the better with regards to technology. And it used to be a lot harder to get the same type of quality results that you can get now with very inexpensive cameras. And so I think there's a lot more tools available to young filmmakers that there weren't available when I was, getting started. And the cost factor, as technology improves, the cost factor decreases. And I think that is a huge benefit to independent filmmakers who at some point felt that they were priced out of the market. Now they can bring in a quality looking picture for very little money. And that's only really happened in the last couple of years. I feel that film has finally gotten to a point where it's been eclipsed by video, mm-hmm. not just from a financial standpoint, but from a quality standpoint.
But you also believe that it's not always the technical aspect of the film. It's also people still want to see a good story.
Yeah, just because you have the technology to go out and make a high quality looking film and a good product,
if it's not a good story, right? If it's not a good story, people are just going to get bored and walk right out. They're not going to stay.
People, the thing is, if you've got a great story, it doesn't matter if you shoot it on a phone. People will be interested in watching it. So it's not about the technology. It's not about the resolution or anything like that. It's all about, what are you trying to say?
Exactly. And you also said something very interesting, too, about distribution, that how to make the money with the distribution of the film. Share that with my audience a little bit.
Well, I just feel that, again, there's a lot more alternative methods that you can turn to rather than just handing it off to an intermediate distributor who not always has the best interest at heart of the independent filmmaker. Whereas now you can, my recommendation is to try and maintain as much or retain as much control as possible with your work. Because at the end of the day, you're going to do a lot of this marketing and promotion yourself anyway.
Some don't. Some people don't.
Well,
some filmmakers don't have that talent. They don't know how to market their film. They're really bad at it.
Then they're in the wrong business. If you don't have the ability to go out and tell people why they should see your film, get people excited about your work, if you don't have the desire to go out and work the market and get people interested, then you're in the wrong business. Then go do accounting, because this is what it's all about. It's absolutely a business, and it's absolutely, if you want to continue to make films, you've got to show that you can be profitable making these films. Otherwise, it's just a hobby. And there's lots of people out there with cameras who are doing this as a hobby. This is a business. Telling stories takes tremendous discipline. I think the only disadvantage to having all this technology readily available at such a low inexpensive price, is that it's available to anyone, and you don't have to suffer the discipline of earning the right to go out and make a film. Now anyone can go and do it. So now the problem with that is that a lot of these films that maybe shouldn't have been made are being made. And I think even though there's a dearth of material out there that you're competing with, it still all comes down to story and quality. And if you tell a good story and you tell a quality film, the technology is there, you can get it out there, and you can still be successful.
Well, you are a fascinating man, fascinating gentleman, and I thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us. I want you to tell my audience where we can find out more information about you as a director, filmmaker. Where can we go?
You can go to my website. My company website is crimsonfilms.org, and you can also view Bereavement or Malevolence or Brutal Massacre or Comedy. They're all available on Netflix or anywhere else you get movies.
And YouTube too, right?
YouTube? Sure, YouTube, Amazon, Best Buy, Walmart, all those places.
And we'll be back in a moment, darling. So more celebrity interviews. Pink champagne kisses.
damn it, move your flabby ass already.
You know, a little makeup, some new clothes, you could be really beautiful. I wouldn't be able to resist you then.
Do whatever the hell you want, but I'm warning you. Don't fuck me on this.
I seem to recall now that a package didn't come for you today.
Two bodies, one male, one female, multiple stab wounds, and... Bite marks. Well, big bites, actually. Like, maybe somebody got hungry?
What if something's wrong?
Chill, Del. Bree's a big girl.
Getting to be like the Bermuda Triangle around here.
For fuck's sake, Gerald! You don't want to touch me anymore! You don't want to kiss me anymore! You don't even want to look at me anymore!
This hill's a special burger. I call it my little wish burger.
A wish burger?
I don't know what's wrong with me. I'm just so hungry.
What you got there? Another one?
Yep. Fire up the oven.
Aquila Lane, and we are here at the Macabre Film Festival right here in Rockville Center, Long Island. It's all about horror. It's all about indie films, and I'm here with this very famous individual, and he's going to introduce himself to the camera.
Hello, I'm Edward X. Young. I'm a horror film actor, makeup special effects artist, and director. I've directed one picture.
Directed one film. Tell my audience about that project, the film that you did direct.
I directed a short film, which is likely to be in the next Macabre Film Festival. It's called Two Guys, One Box.
Oh, my God. Two Guys, One Box. That sounds loaded.
It is loaded. It's a Lovecraftian horror comedy.
Tell my audience, where can we go to find out more information about you as an actor, as a director? What projects you're working on? Do you have a website?
No, I don't have a website, but you can look me up at IMDb, or you can contact me through Facebook.
Tell my audience your Facebook page,
well,
your name.
Just look up my name, Edward X. Young.
Edward X.
Put the middle initial in there, X for Xavier. I chose the middle name. I took it from... the 1932 Lionel Atwell horror science fiction movie, Dr. X. His name was Dr. Xavier in that picture. I am the lead actor in a movie called Mr. Hush, which has been in the red boxes. It's on Netflix. It's in stores coast to coast. And I act with a lot of, it's directed by David Lee Madison, and it's a retro horror tribute. And a lot of big stars are in it. We have a Stephen Jeffries from Fright Night is in that as my evil henchman.
Love the name, Mr. Hush. And we'll be back in a moment, darlings, with more celebrity interviews right here at the Macabre Film Festival in Rockville, Long Island. Keep watching, darlings. Pink champagne kisses.
Fallacy dress to impress. One of a kind girl.
It's been a Crybaby Productions, darlings.